we're going to continue with our little UI trick. And when about a week or two ago, I thought, what am I going to tell at LGM? I thought, well, let's do some challenging stuff. So I put two topics on the menu for discussing with you today. And in the meanwhile, I've even worked out the slides, so we can get started. So my name is Peter Sikking. I'm an interaction architect. I do the UI stuff for a living, yes. I run a company in Berlin called My Machine Interface Works. And as part of that, I do quite a bit of open source work on GIMP and on open printing. Every talk I start with the same slides is to explain what the hell do I do. So we start with what a normal architect does. And you can read here, it's also tips from presenting. Do not read out the slides. It's white on black, as you can see. And this is the most text that you're going to see, actually, for a slide. So to explain instead of to read, the environment is the landscape or the street. It's not about making it pretty architecture. It's about really making buildings work for humans. And it's to work with the engineers on feasibility, and it's the engineers who make the buildings stand up. This is what I do. Surprise, surprise, it's not that different. The environment here is desktop, handheld, the web. It's again not about making it pretty, although it doesn't hurt. It's about making software work mostly at all for humans. And I work with engineers on feasibility. And it's the engineers who are responsible for the bugs and explosions. So my software plays at the moment. Here's the first of the two big themes I want to talk about. And a while ago I was explaining a visual designer I work with who also did our website about GIMP, and suddenly she says, yeah, what about SMUC? And I was like, what? And yeah, SMUC, that's how you can pronounce it in German. So, and we heard this yesterday in the talk, like immediately asking like, oh, if this is supposed to be high-end software, graphic software, does it deal with CMYK? And so that's very familiar. Also today the topic was there, again about CMYK, and I'm happy to address it. I think we can deal with it in GIMP. So it's a bit of a hot debate. First of all, there's this user side of, it must be done. Can we build it in? Can we have an edit mode like that? And then we got GIMP developers saying rigorously, no. So, then you can ask yourself, is CMYK really a UI issue? Or is it just a color space and it's technical, and you build it in and you do conversions and etc. I think this is one of a classic little sample where both the UI design, but especially the mediating powers over from the interaction architect can help to bring these two worlds together and to deliver a solution that's satisfactory to both and actually covers the yes and the no that's hanging in the air right now about CMYK. So recently, the issue flared up again on the GIMP developer mailing list. The issue is self-perpetuating. So if there's a slight angle to some posting about, in this case, just professional PDF workflows and stuff like that, we slide it straight away into the CMYK debate. And yeah, since it's been bugging me also for years, we started fishing for more information. And in this case, from list users who seriously use this stuff, who seriously do press work. And in this case, I just started listening to do something what is called, what is still called understanding activity. instead of jotting down a wish list of what everybody wants, it's about really find out behind like how people work with this, what they're trying to achieve, and what is demanded from them, and yeah, more about the big picture than just a list of features, and to come up with an understanding of the activity. So one of the surprising things that finally hit home with me is that it's not about CMYK, the whole thing. And it's about printing presses. It's about taking your work of art and bringing it to mass production on printing presses. And when I say printing presses, it's not a printer like this. It's the one with operators, and I even imagine they still have levers on them, on these presses, and hydraulic parts, and not only something that's actuated by a couple of relays or something. So that's the first thing to keep in mind. This is not separation for the printer in your room. This is something that, yeah, that has its own building around it, I would say. Think big. And the next thing is, it's about printing presses, but especially about the plates that you find on those printing presses that put each color on the paper. And for this understanding, I'm indebted to Pippin. He's been bugging me about this also for years, and has been drilling me last Guadec about this, really about this. So finally, it all combines with what users are really talking about and what their requirements are. That it's no longer about the graphics files. It's really about those plates on those presses. And another thing that in discussion was really interested was that Louis Desjardins said, like, look on packaging, look on what's happening there. So next time I was in my kitchen making coffee, I looked at the bottom of my milk carton, and what I found was a 7-color printing job, actually 7 separate colors, 7 plates on the big printing press that printed that carton. And what's really interesting is that 0 of them were C, M, Y, or K. It was all different colors, and they were used solored and mixed, so screened on that milk carton. And that's for something that's really cheap, actually. But they probably print a million of them at one time. And actually, the designer that featured in my schmuck and anecdote, she was really surprised that they spent so much money on that kind of packaging, but I guess it pays off if you print a million of them. So, and that really hit home something about CMYK if you're gonna build it into an application. Lots of stuff is printed with more than just these 4 colors, or it doesn't use one of these CMYK channels, and or as like the milk carton, it uses 0 of that. So why go through all the trouble of hardwiring something like that into GIMP when it really reminds me of the way the London Underground has been designed and still was designed recently, like under-designed for totally not adequate from the first day of use that it opened up, like the Jubilee Line extension. Stations that were immediately swamped by the number of passengers that went through it. So it sounds really like criminally negligent to build, to hardwire a CYMK mode into GIMP. It's similar like introducing color into an application and think, you know what, we're just gonna do it with index color. 256 colors, that's good enough. Although the world out there is for ages in 24-bit or more RGB color. So I don't think we should do that. And that's really my first point for this. It's about the plates, and it's not about CMYK, and those plates can be configured in any kind of way, whatever is fit for the print job. Second point is also what Louis really hit home. It's the control of those plates. Once you start thinking about how things are going to roll out of the printing press, it's really about an expert setup. And even more important for me, understanding activity is, after it's been set up, it for sure will need fine-tuning. And I do not underestimate how much work that is and how refined that's going to be. I basically say that once you got the plates separated out and you got it on your screen in GIMP, it's going to take the full GIMP functionality to massage it into something that really that's really good enough to fit to print really. So that's the second topic that we need to understand. It's about that expert users need to be in control of that. Not just, like I said this morning, click a button, it's separated, and you're done. There's no such thing. Then there is a factor that we need to understand about creative work. The creative work is on screen. That's where the content is made. That's where the creative concept is developed, worked out, touched up, etc. And that's a loop, really, of user tool image. You see the image, it goes back to user tool image. It just goes on and on and on and on. And part of that is conceptual, what they want to achieve. Part is that is reacting to how it works out and working further on that. And so really the medium where you're working is the screen, and the natural representation that is RGB. And we also heard that yesterday, like RGB is easy, CYMK is the difficult part. It's on a technical level, it really figures out that if you're working on a screen on a computer, then the RGB is the natural medium. And hence I conclude from that, and I'm signing there on the side with the developers level, that any creative work is work in RGB. So what about that schmuck file? I mean, if you get a file, God knows what, over the wire these days, and it's in CMYK. I mean, now that we sort of understand what we understand up to now, it must have been somewhere for a printing press. I mean, it's not natural to store something like that or to work in something like that when it's really for screen or in creative development. So it's expressed in the natural language of a CYMYK printing press. So there's two things I think you can do with it, or that's the reason why you open it at all. One is you're asked to fine-tune that for that press because it didn't work out as people expected, and after a test it needs some massaging. Or it's something you found, something was given to you, and you want to stick it into your own collage or whatever you're making on your poster, and in that case I think the best thing is to import it and convert it to RGB, because that's the natural medium for creative work. So that's what I want to understand about CMYK files. And last thing, and this is really what goes beyond what users even tell you, or this is a deeper understanding of what the workflow is like. And in theory, everything is very straightforward. It's called a waterfall model, and it's just ABC. You create on your monitor, you separate it for the printer, it goes to the printing press, everything comes out, that's it. But and that's also in color models and conversion, etc., the safest, soundest method of getting this thing through. However, realities of working of visual designers and any creative person is you work with other people, and those printing presses are not that predictable on screen what is going to come out. So it's iterative work, and yeah, that really means that you create, you want to already check out how it's going to work out with some kind of soft preview, soft profiling on your computer. if really those fat colors you want is going to work out. Doesn't, you go back, you adjust that, but also you drive your own creative development further. You go to a client, he also says like, well, this and this, or you have your own internal further thoughts or criticism. So you're jumping up and down and up and down, creative processing and the massaging, the fine tuning of the actual print job. Of which, yes, the last step can be that you finally do some tweaks in spelling error on the poster or something like that. So it's not that, so you cannot force people down a straight pipeline all the time, like create, separate, and then to the press, because they have to start from scratch the whole time. And so it's really my job to square that circle. So on the one hand, technically it should be straightforward. You see that people who have to work, have to deal with clients, have to deal with their own perfectionism, need to be able to switch all the time between a RGB mode and separated, say, CMYK mode. So to take us on the solution, we're gonna have a bit of an interlude, and it's a solution that that we dreamed up already a year or more ago for Index Color. Index Color, I think on the first LGM I even participated and I was just writing down a vision with the GIMP guys. Index Color is gonna disappear from GIMP. It's really something you don't wanna think about, that you still have these 256 or 16 colors to work with. It's just all gonna be in color, RGB, and in the future it's gonna be a ludicrous amount of fidelity that you're going to get per component. So a solution to real support workflows for Index Color, I mean, images still got to be made for web and at games and etc., is something like this. That's what we dreamed of. You got your image, it's already a bit enlarged so you can see the pixels, and you work in full fidelity and the file is always going to stay like that. When it's time to get worried about how this is going to look in 16 colors, you sort of pull down a projection over it that shows you how that's really going to be once you sampled it down to 16 colors. So that's called a projection. And at that moment, on that projection, you should be able to do your corrective work. To take a pencil, to take a paintbrush, and really make those shadows a lot smoother than they are. Within the limitations of having only 16 colors available, this should enable you to concentrate on getting the best result in 16 colors without hurting your full fidelity work. So you do your fine tuning. I'm not good with graphics, so I cannot show you that. But imagine that it's gonna be a whole lot better. And yes, then it's time to export it. The original in the game file is still full fidelity, but this export has now been touched up. And that is the core of the solution for working for printing presses. The point where, with me, the coin dropped was recently there was in, let's see if I can pronounce that without, is it called Ars Technica?
Yeah.
Why is it called Ars? But anyway, the GIMP community found that sort of the first good or well done, well performed review of GIMP ever, as in competently done. And it also mentioned again CMYK in the current rather cumbersome way of dealing with it. One thing that it mentioned was really interesting. It's this whole process of your creative work and then separating for the printing press and working on that. It really draw a comparison with how records are made. They're recorded, then they are mastered for either LPs or CDs. And that's all about dealing with the lower resolution and the deficiencies of the actual end medium. And that's suddenly having this idea of, okay, you start in hi-fi and then it goes to less-fi, is something that we're seeing here. And that's why I can now show you the solution that is quite analogous to what I just showed you. So First of all, it's going to be 1.0 for the developers. Yes, inside GIMP, all the work is going to be in RGB. We really would like that all the plugins keep working and certainly not done to rewrite all plugins from everybody to different color models. And even there will be implicit conversions that are not round trip safe, as it's called. So you can go up and down and up and down and up and down to CMYK without losing fidelity. So RGB is it for all creative work. Second of all, say this is your interface. You worked up the nice poster, and it's got these layers to put it all together. And now, similar to the 16 color case, we're gonna pull down a projection that's already the profiled with paper profile, printer profile, etc. What it's gonna look like when it comes from the printer. So you pull it down, and you see the layers actually disappeared. At this point, we're just thinking about the printing press. It's going to be on one piece of paper, so there's only one layer. However, there are the plates, and I just give them the name of what I think are the colors that that need a different plate, and lo and behold, it's already a five-color print job, and there's not too much, this component of C, of Y, and K missing there already. And you can see that if you saw the transition, yeah, because of the profiling, etc., it's already slightly off. So we focus on the plates, that's what we work for. And of course, the whole magic of doing the separation of working with CY or with ink curves and having stuff like the limit of ink that it can be on the paper on the same spot and stuff like trapping, it's all in this conversion that's part of this mask that you, or this projection you pull already over it. The setup of that is the setup of your whole print job. Of course, this is not CMYK, but CMYK is going to be the bog standard default for doing this kind of stuff, but it needs the flexibility to do that 7-color milk package, for instance. What is also really, or what has to work is that the blue text and the red text that you see there, it's really going to bypass the whole compositing. It's going to be able to pull straight from the layer onto the blue plate, that blue text. And in that way, it can deal with situations like spot colors really nicely. Now, to support this whole workflow, it's crucial that if you flip up this projection again, now you can keep working on your creative processes. You can update the poster, get that spelling error. There is probably none, but say there is one, you can get that out. The feedback from the customer, change the trumpet to a saxophone, etc. You can just do it, and when you flip down the mask again, everything is already set up, and any kind of painting treatment you did on these plates one by one to sort things out, any kind of adjustment layers or adjustments you put on there are simply in a non-destructive way going to be applied again. And in this way, we really have now a situation where within a matter of an hour, you can work 50 minutes on the creative stuff, then you work 10 minutes on massaging your printing plates, then you flip open the mask, up the mask again, and you you do further development of the actual concept. You check again what it's going to look like. You bring the print job and have a test print. It comes back. There was that spelling mistake that needs to be taken out. And of course, some further massaging on getting the color of the trumpet right. It all can be done without being stuck in a certain, in a one-way pipeline where you can only go one way in and the other way out. There's still the question, what are we going to do with the CMYK file? So, yeah, as I said, one thing was tune up. It's pretty simple. It goes as a fixed kind of concept into the actual printing projection. You can apply your changes on there, all the massaging you want. Of course, since it was already CMYK, it's not possible to do creative further development on it. It's all going to be done there. For creative development, it really has to be important, and that's really like like doing scan work or taking pictures from a camera. It really needs some massaging before it it looks good in your normal GIMP file. So that's it for the whole issue of not CMYK. And the second thing I want to talk about, and it's going to be a bit faster, is what is known as a user request number one. Some kind of single window mode. And you can see that in the GIMP brainstorm. Just going to have a look at some of those contributions people are sending into the GIMP brainstorm. And it's all single window mode. So obviously there is a demand for this. That's something you can conclude from a brainstorm. First of all, what are people thinking about? Where's there a need? And the second thing is that every once in a while there is a good idea hidden in there. That's the address of the brainstorm, where everything is published, and anyone can send in an idea as long as it's on an image. So there's a lot of a demand for this, but this is also more inside than hard statistics or something like that. You can just see that from the way it's spoken about, how it's discussed and how fiery the discussions are among users about this kind of stuff. It's a 50-50 world. So half of the people like how it is today and they're content, and the other half wants it changed and for various reasons, and we will have to deal with it. So this is not a case where you can ram down one change and have it done and everybody's happy. So we're going to need two modes, and there's got to be one switch to switch between that. Getting to the topic of customization, as it was before, if there's something I'm not going to do about this, is stick this somewhere in the preferences where it will be, well, the preferences is the graveyard for any good idea. So if you stick it in there, you're sure that not too many people will bother you about it. So it's going to be something that's in the view menu, this one switch to switch between the two modes. And yeah, we're really going to work on it, that it's, with a couple of simple techniques, 99% of users can really now tweak their UI and just put it like they want to, and that's it. So let me take one of the nicer images that we saw from the brainstorm, and yeah, it's sort of going to look like this. Everything together in the window. There's tabs. Well, alas, there's only one tab there, but you can imagine three images open, three tabs, just like in a web browser, that show you the image you're working on, and it's all in a single window. Now, we need a bit of flexibility because, for instance, there's people with two monitors, and it's a bit awkward if they should span those two monitors that are maybe not even equal size. So we need to be able to detach any kind of palettes and docking, dialogues. In this way, you can really arrange that on one screen you got your image or your images together in tabs, and on the other one you got your collection of tools and dockables. Now, I have nothing against that. Yeah, they can mix, they can side dock the toolbox over there. It's actually in this image nice and slim, like it should be. And that one is floating. It can overlap a bit, can be on another monitor. You can do whatever you want. So for my next trick, and that's actually the second part of what really should happen, is that we should have multi-column of this multi-column dockables to really start for bigger monitors and for, especially for the two monitor situation, to keep together in an organized way all that. You can just start filling this up also with dialogues again to do this in multiple columns. There's a couple of things I'm really apprehensive about, and this is really a start of a discussion. Of course, we think like, okay, we got a tapped GIMP in a one window, and it's like tab browsing, isn't it? The most advanced of those have now that you can tear off the tabs and start a new window. And I don't see that really happening, and especially since you tear off a tab and your single window interface is suddenly two windows. And then comes the question like, okay, which of the two is going to have the toolbox and the dock toolbox, etc. And here is where a very simple ID that's very easy to follow also for users, and it's got just about two rules that you need to know, starts to get complicated. Now, if you've got the old GIMP situation, every image is in its own window. Side docking of those palettes and docks to each and every image window, again, difficult, because then it's about, you bring a window to the front, are the docks going to move with it? Are they always there? Are you going to have dock salad? And just have three windows, and you see the palettes and the palettes next to each other. It's going to be a bit of a recipe for disaster, I think, especially since in the palettes and the dockables, like the layer dialog, it's a mix of global stuff that is the same for all of GIMP. And some of the, well, quite a few of these dialogues really reflect which image is in front. And that's really what's going to break up for single window mode. Like, so this question, okay, you put it in tabs, how are you going to compare images? I mean, they're all behind each other. Yeah, that's going to be difficult. I'm thinking hard about what can be done there. Like, you can think like, okay, I can tear off one and view it with the other. I can start splitting panes inside the tabs or that, or inside my window, and have different tabs in different panes. But you really get in trouble with what's the current image, because your layers dialog, your histogram, everything needs to reflect what the current image is like. So we have to keep it simple. Or, and that's my last point, we need to do everything of that. And that's something we have to investigate. It's like this kind of design exercise that you, on paper, really have to go through how that all has to work. That it is possible in the tapped interface to tear off windows, to have two image windows, which are by themselves single window, that dependent on which windows to the front, it cut the palettes and all the docks. If they're docked. If they're floating, they're simply floating, etc. And you have the possibility to compare or to split. It's a kind of situation where I see an opportunity to make it all work together, but it's a 25% chance, I would say, that it can all work. If not, then all the stuff is simply not going to work, and we're going to keep it sweet and simple, but we got a one window mode. And with that, we're at the end of what I was going to tell you today.
From the original to the converted image.
What you are editing at that moment is that once you pull down a projection, in a sense your projection is your base image. It's the composited
creative image that you work on, so all layers combined in the way that you specified. But at that point, it's a flat single image again on top, and it's been separated into plates, and each plate can now be edited again with all the graphics tools that that GIMP has, actually. So each plate is actually a monochrome image that then you can do everything you want. If you want to blur it, that's fine with me. If you want to select half of it and delete it, that's fine with me. It's really, you can do anything you want. But the whole point is, of course, that this, that the original image that you made is not changed by that. It's only the projection of that image that gets further treatment built on top of it, which is a central principle that we're going to build in of non-destructive editing. You start with a good begin situation and then you pile up each treatment or each operation that you do. And if you open the file months later, each of that step is still selectable, changeable, and is then instantly reapplied on top of each other, which is quite central to this kind of workflow.
So would it be useful to consider being able to edit the mapping function? Because I can imagine maybe you have a circumstance where you have two pixels that are close together, and they're slightly different. And so what happens is with projections you get, you know, you have this thresholding where one goes to one value and one goes to another value. And you might want to just tweak the mapping function and say, well, actually consider all pixels with this one color, this other color.
There will be several ways of doing this. First of all, this attack or dealing with the mapping function itself, but that's maybe too fundamental for what you're actually doing. The other thing is to color select all these pixels and adjust them. That's one operation you're doing on a certain mask. But that's something that when you flip up and down the mask every time, it's going to be applied every time, even if you swapped out that trumpet for a saxophone, it's all going to work again because you select the same pixels with the same color and do that adjustment. So it's the whole point is, of course, to not break this flow of creatively working on, of working on creative stuff and then working very near, well, you're working very near to the actual printing process. Not to break how that's jumbling your head from, oh, I gotta do this, and oh, I gotta do that, and oh, I gotta do this, and don't have any penalties that your previous work is undone and you have to start again. That's what we're trying to achieve here.
I think actually you just answered this, but just to be clear, so you maintain an edit list on projection, and if you change the original image, then all those changes will be reapplied to the new version, it will continue to flow through. Is that correct?
Yes, that's, and I took that a bit too implicitly in my talk. That's the way.
It's an important thing. It's been easy to go the other way and say, oh, no, once you made your projection, that's it, and you've
broken
the link. So
that's this waterfall model of, like, once you're through the tunnel, you're stuck. You can only go around and go again through the whole tunnel. Now, what's central to GIMP or the future of GIMP is that any operation is still changeable and automatically reapplied in order as it was ever done, even if you go back to the file years later.
I know this way because you have talked about layers, okay? And my question would be, what about the basic system layer with a kind of mod editing layer as it does in Blender?
Sorry, tell me then.
Yes, my question is about layer. Okay. I wonder if the layers are a good solution to allow non-destructive modification. And if it would not be better to use mod editor system as the Blender does or as other value editing software does.
Figure out what you're asking.
He's asking for adjustment layers, I think.
I thought it was.
He's asking for a graph, actually. Instead of having a layer stack, having a layer graph.
Now, there's two really interesting concepts you have. One is the adjustment layers, and one is the graph. As whenever I look at the screenshot of Blender, I see these boxes with hoses. And so first, adjustment layers. That's going to be in GIMP at one point, but that's for creative work. at that point, there will be two ways or two very natural ways to say half desaturate your image. On the one hand, it's like, yeah, when you simply get a photo and it's on one layer, then the most natural thing is just to apply that one operation on the layer itself, where it's still stacked up and selectable. And it's silly when you got one photo to put an adjustment layer on top of it. That's really bad UI. To force yourself into this kind of situation that you have to project this extra layer on top of it just to get a bit of 50% desaturation done. On the other hand, it's also very silly that when you got a collage of 100 layers with all kinds of found objects, and you got this collage perfectly, and then you want to increase the contrast of it, that you have to go through these 100 layers to apply to that. So that's where an adjustment layer is really cool, because in one time, you stick this whole adjustment over it, and those 100 layers just gonna project through it. So that's sort of the balance of where it will be going. However, users will think is the easiest way to get a 50% desaturation done, either on the layer itself or by sticking a layer, adjustment layer over it, it will be possible. And both of these will be 1 year later. You can click on each of these, the adjustment layer or the step that you took on the layer itself, and you can adjust it to 33% because that's what you want 1 year later. Going to the boxes and hoses. I know that kind of stuff from way back, and it was called visual programming. And when we really talk about what is fit to be used by visual artists, by visual designers, I think that's not mainstream. I mean, working in GIMP is not programming. If there's one thing I want to achieve with GIMP, is still that the image is big right in front of you. You pick up some instrument or you pick up some tool and just start doing this. And that operation will simply another thing that you've done to that layer or to that image. I can imagine, because one part of the product vision of GIMP is that it's a tool for researching graphics algorithms, that at some points we really introduce that this Gecko graph of operations, and it is a graph, is for a special programming researching mode, is going to be exposed, and there, for that kind of target group, they will be able to go into that. But for general use, for natural working, for people who really have those general skills of working on graphics and knows what it means to mask off stuff and apply a lot of brushwork, it's simply got to be the most natural way that we can think of, which is hand and do it like that. And that's what I'm trying to achieve.
I still don't understand the fundamental incompatibility between GIMP and Prepress, but I meant to ask if you're familiar with the work of Bill Atkinson in his nature photography and the techniques he figured out for doing a single test print off of a printing press and then calibrating it, and then calibrating the software exactly to that press, essentially avoiding the entire loop of constantly adjusting the printing press to get the proper color mixtures.
I know Bill Atkinson, and it's a it's a huge hero of what he did for. He wrote MacPaint 1.0, the granddad of all applications. Again, what you're painting here is a very specific use case for, first of all, a very specific content that is a full color photo, probably, and then getting it out of a, I have to guess, CYMK printer or a six color printer or even more color printer. And if you saw the jazz poster, it would be silly to separate it in CMYK because some of those in-between colors, it will be much more expressive to really take the right kind of orange-red and just print it as on one plate on there, and you got a full-covered, non-rasterized trumpet that you got there on your poster. So again, this assumes that the world is just limited to CMYK and that's how it works. As soon as you think about creative work like that poster and you got some colors that are Pantone definable and stuff like that, you got a totally custom
separation. And at that point, it's all about the experience of the actual designer and knowing how to bring things in print that is going to save the day. There's no amount of software that is really will be able to compensate for that situation.
So you're saying it's stupid. It is stupid to make a stipple pattern of CMYK when you could just have a separate ink for each color in the printer.
If it's feasible, yes. If it's economically feasible, especially, yes.
But why not leave that decision to the user?
We do, because exactly the setup of this projection screen, which means how many plates are you going to have, what color is going to be on them, and how it's going to be mapped from the core, from the composite image, and customize each layer. What you want to bring the blue text directly to the blue layer. You're going to bypass the whole compositing stage and just say, oh, all the text from that layer, it goes directly on the blue, on the light blue plate. And that's how you really avoid any kind of funny errors in between in a conversion. It's a direct expression of that text is light blue, and that's how it's going to come out of the printing press. What was your question again? No, it is not always silly to rasterize, but it's a matter of economics and how simple and bold your image is, if it's possible. But if you take the milk carton, it's a 7-color job. A lot of the logos and stuff on that were in solid, in 3 of the colors of that 7-color job were just solid colors for the logo. And other stuff was rasterized and to bring out gradients from light blue to blue, for instance, behind the cow on the grass field of the milk carton.
Okay, I just want to touch on the Blender boxes and poses type of approach, and especially when you mention what's natural, and you're trying to focus on the natural workflow. One thing I've seen and observed many times in designing apps is that there's not just one natural, and one of the key ways it manifests is that I usually design for at least 2 different types of people. One of which, if you tell them, tell them how to get to your house, they'll write down a list of directions as a list. Turn left, go down, turn right, go 2 blocks. Whereas there's the other type of person who will draw a map, and they're just mentally, conceptually different, naturally different. And so what's natural for one group is not natural for the other. And that's at least those 2 different ways of thinking I've found are minimum of the different as far as natural, and I think for the population where their first impulse is to draw a map, those are the people who naturally use the Blender type pose and box thing a little easier. But I just haven't looked into how it fits in, especially for image editing and GIMP and some other stuff, where it would fit in the timeline of the priority of what to do first.
Well, yeah, the interesting aspect is there, of course, and you bring it up, like, yes, there's not a user, there's always a huge spread of users, and it's all Gauss curves in many dimensions, how people tick and how they understand stuff and what do they work on. And another thing that actually is in here is, and I think it was mentioned before in the last talk, that all the stuff we do is not context-free. If we go back to MacPaint 1.0, it's still, well, not even traces. Lots of that is still in GIMP today. It's in any painting application today that you actually, I mean, Bill Eckerson came up with this palette stuff. He came up with these palettes that there are actually modes, but they're so natural that, because it fits with what you want to do, that you just go along, where the modes in VI and stuff like that are terrible. In this case, it was so natural to grab a brush and do that, and grab a bucket and fill it with paint, that it actually worked. Now, in my work for GIMP, I do part of it is really, yeah, driving with a bulldozer over old stuff and then building something new. And part of that is really respecting the tradition of how it worked, but all of that is always from the point of, if we change it, it's got to be obviously better. And it's got to be fit for the activity, which we always concentrate on, that it is creative work. And that this loop of what the state that the image is, the concept that's in the head, the goals that have to achieve, and the tools, and the many ways that a change that needs to be made is going to be achieved, that it all is there, and that it goes, that that little cycle just keeps spinning and spinning and spinning and spinning and spinning while the image is being made. And that's what we're trying to achieve. And at the end, if you ask me why not boxes and hoses for GIMP, that's a designer intuitive decision, that it doesn't feel right in how far we can, in how far we can really reach something to, or reach our goals via that route. And there's, apart from setting up a huge controlled experiment where you build two of those GUIs and then figure out how they're doing with the right kind of users, because we still have a target group, and it's not like anybody wants to use, should work brilliantly with GIMP. So the only substitute for that is design and evaluating ahead and choosing a strategic direction in which way we're going to develop the UI.
Yeah. I really like it. Never just it's not about UIK, but about plates. On the other hand, I don't really see how color match comes into it. So you say you want to work with RGB and has high fidelity, but of course there's a problem with garments, and there are some printing colors which are not cannot be displayed in RGB. But so you do really need color management, and if you want to
have RGB
color space, then RGB
certainly
not RGB. So
the internal space.
Yeah, I'm not going to tie myself down which RGB that is, and GIMP is taking a first step at the moment already at color management. I also immediately realized when I talk about the activity here that the only people who are really going to do well with this kind of separation and bring to printing presses are people who fully understand all the things that can go wrong when you go from that one medium that is that calibrated or not monitor that you work on from one color space that is by nature going to be RGB based because that's how it comes up with you. And you go to a printed medium where you need to take inside that separation, you need to take into account the profile of the printing press, the paper you use. Talking to Louis over lunch and something like with how many kilometers an hour it runs through the press is also going to have an effect on that. And it's for sure that you're talking here about some of the most difficult stuff that you can do with GIMP is bring that JS poster to a press and get 10,000 or 100,000 of them printed actually. And it needs, for sure, it's not going to be one click and anybody can do it. This is pure 100% depending on the competence of the person who uses that. And it's nothing goes automatic there. And the only thing, I was going to mention it in my talk, but yeah, when you see that projection, it's going to be a fair projection. There's no guarantees that this is going to assist. It's just going to assist in a better way than ever estimating how it will come off that press.
I'm going to first comment on right which colors you can represent. I'm not talking about the colors that in the kind of CMYK is four dimensional, but just for like the gamut, photometrically. And the thing is, an 8-bit sRGB color space will have a gamut limiting it. If you have a floating point, say linear light, RGB space that most values are higher than the grain plus negative values, you effectively have an unbounded space, okay, limited by the precision of the point. But that is the color space that the GIMP is operating internally, is linear light, floating point, unbounded gamut color. And if you want to direct something very specific to a plate, you would have a grayscale layer, perhaps even you would only have like fully separated, like fully printed layer for this pixel. Say I put this on that plate. So you could effectively probably have like a color image and an additional plate to the top, which would really be black and like only affects to the black based on one layer in your original image composition. But I'm going to
address the poses and boxes.
Oh, doodles.
Doodles. Okay. this is a point where some of the engineers disagree with some interactive designers. And we have an ongoing discussion. And personally, I don't think the graph of spaghetti that user has the hood and manage and when it reaches complexity has to go, oh no, I have to really have my graph, is the way to go forward. I actually believe that a hierarchy, which includes both elements that are kind of like layers currently in, but also back layers, but you should be able to nest them in a hierarchy, and a lot of clones, then you can express almost everything you can in a graph, and the user doesn't have to manage the spatial layer complexity of it. And I'm working on Peter, convincing that something along those lines might be a good way to go. But
it's not going to look like also the box.
No, it's not.
I mean, in a model that we already this far have developed, it still will look like this kind of stuff you can see in layer hierarchies at the moment in the pixel editor that we dare not name its name. And those are trees already by themselves, so it's pretty close to covering lots of graph type stuff when you do that. One of the goals of meeting here in LGM, now that I got this over with, is to have an informal buff where we really talk about advanced compositing and the ideas of Pippin of what beyond what you can see today in normal graphics applications, what can be done. And I think any kind of advanced ideas of how with boxes and hoses stuff you can really build some truly interesting images or animations. It's welcome to bring in now, and then the next step is the process is of course making that displayable in UI that doesn't look like visual programming, but simply look at working on some layers, on some images, and have some adjustment layers and some other kind of funky stuff, but all within the realm of visual design. No, he's got the mic.
Okay, so
oh, that's really loud. So over there was a comment about you can't use RGB if you want color fidelity, and that's completely not true. But I think there's a confusion coming out between the RGB and the monitor that you're using, and the RGB in which you're designing, which don't have to be the same, and often are not the same. One of the things that people used to do when Photoshop first got color management was they set the working color space to be whatever their profile monitor was. And they thought, that's nice and easy, it's one-to-one, I can switch off all the previewing stuff and I'm just working directly, but then the file that you have is specific to your monitor and then someone else has to convert it. So if you're using a wider gamut color space like Beta RGB or Adobe RGB or one of those sort of things, you can have an arbitrarily large gamut. And you can cover much of what any particular CMYK press can do.
Mm. Even in 8-bit depth?
No, absolutely not. No,
you can go over 8-bits?
It will, by the time it is in. Of course, yeah. It will be
absolutely. I mean, one of the reasons I have not used GIMP and refused to until it fixed itself was because it was limited to 8-bits per component. And now it's not, then that means I might start using it.
Martin, start with you. But still the good part of that story was that all those things you mentioned ended with RGB and not with block or something else that you have to work in.
Also note that if the format allows negative numbers, you have no, in any color space, you have no gamut limits whatsoever.
Which is something I've been saying for a while until people pointed out to me that A, the transfer curve is undefined beyond zero, and the current color management systems all truncate to zero. So while what you say is colorimetrically correct, it is outside the current state of the art color management systems, unfortunately.
If it's a linear map, then it's not.
So Louis, probably the last question, no Louis?
So as I understand it, for the separations you're going to offer things in RGB, and you're going to have a bunch of layers which are RGB or a lot of grayscale maps.
know, I skipped the varnishes and the lacquers and metallic colors. It's in one of the slides because this is also what it makes me drilling me with. Like, you can do that on a screen with a bit of animation, or and then when you got something shiny and put some matte lacquer over it, you take away the part of the animation again. It's not going to be perfect, but it's better than a cyan layer that you see there. Now about that, the setup of the actual projection, which is the setup of your separation, that's what you do, is going to be crucial. And to support different users there again, it's going to have a super default that is standard kind of CMYK separation with some kind of profiles of printers and etc. And it's cross your finger, push one button, and it sort of comes out. The other end of the spectrum is this kind of a job where there's maybe black, vanilla, CY, and OK. There's six other colors. There's some lacquer sprayed over it as a top layer. And of course, these plates that you saw there in the UI are all like layers, just sortable to what goes on top, of course. That's the most easy part of it, I would say. But yeah, the secret is in the setup of that projection screen, which is your separation. And that's where we got to arrange for super default to everything custom and really saying this block of text on that layer goes straight as a spot color to that plate in the same position.
Great. I think
that's it.
Well, do you want to add something? Or?
Okay,
well, no, we have the time that we want to take and we will keep.
I just want to make sure to point out something. Printers cannot print an infinite gamut. They have a very limited gamut based on the tolerance. So RGBDS, you can specify all sorts of colors, but the printer can't print out that color all the time. And that's a real problem that designers face. So you can specify something that looks really good on your screen, but you may not be able to print it because of the limited gamut. And that's something you need to be aware of. And then plus, even if you do those separations, then you'll send it off the printer, you come back, it's the wrong colors. So what is that person going to do to try and tweak those colors? You really need to be able to go back, and it's that mapping, the color management that's really, really important in this process.
What you explain now is the heart of what you're seeing there. When you pull up a projection, you immediately can see that fat red is going to look a bit tepid because of the profiles of the paper and it's going to do its best to squeeze that gamut off the actual printer, which can be a bit bigger than you wanted to do, and show, and you actually saw it, I sort of make the poster look a bit more tepid.
What is it that you're going to be putting in there so that the designer can tweak it and fine-tune those colors, knowing that they're using process colors within them? So I think before you were describing how you have those different separation layers, but what can you do to that blue to make it the right color when really you need to add more yellow, for example?
Well, what we want to really achieve is that the original image is not going to be touched for that. It's going to be on the projection screen where you take that blue plate and maybe give it a different curve with the standard curve tool so that it saturates earlier or it sort of has a bit of saturation at the top and it comes up a little sooner. And immediately, with all the profiling of all those printers, you will see that. But this is going to be experiencing, you know, you have to test print and you're like, that's not good enough. And when you've got lots of experience, you can probably also see within the range where it really didn't stick anymore to the paper or got washed out by something else. So you know, even the ranges where it needs a bit of boosting, if that you can express on the blue plate with the curve tool and just do, and it needs 10% more, and then fingers crossed the next run is really going to be good. That's the kind of stuff we want to support there without ever touching the original poster, because you shouldn't mess up your poster just to get the print right, because maybe next day you're asked for the poster to go on a web page and it simply needs to be RGB out down to PNG.
So I just want to suggest, look into what color management groups are doing right now, because some of that is what exactly the point that you're making. That's what they're trying to do, and take the guesswork out of it. So I know my company works a lot with printers, and they have people that are trying to guess, what color should I specify this so it prints out correctly? And it's a very long, tedious process. But having something, we've given them tools now that they can figure this out automatically. And scan the printer, do something, figure that out. And so if they could do that as well, I think that'd be very powerful in the
answer that in a way that color management is a standard part of this, because else it's all for nothing. We're trying to do this kind of stuff. So yes, we're trying our best to, in a bright future, to take all of that into account.
Thank you.
Thank you.